So I'm going to preface this by, like I do all my talks, we didn't have anyone scheduled, so I thought I would come up with a talk that I'm going to give in a couple months. This will be a good dry run for my my talk in November, which is Objectoberfest, this internal initiative we have at our company. Once a year we get together and we learn about stuff. It's called, last year was called Cloudtoberfest, this year it's called Objectoberfest. And we eat food, drink beer, and we learn about something. This year we're learning about object storage. So this is going to be the talk that I'm giving at Objectoberfest, Object Storage 101. Everyone see that? Is the resolution okay?
Okay.
Yeah. Yep, looks good.
Shiny, but
just
yeah.
Looks crappy, but it's fine. So I'll just start off by giving the wiki summary of what object storage is. Object storage is a computer data storage architecture that manages data as objects rather than storage architectures like file systems, which manage data as a file hierarchy, or block storage, which manages data as blocks within separate tracks. Each object includes the data itself and a bit of metadata, and has a global unique identifier. Object storage can be implemented at multiple levels, at the device level, system level, interface level. In each case, object storage seeks to enable capabilities addressed by other storage architectures, like growing snapshots, taking snapshots, reducing space, adding space. And its goal is to be directly accessed from an application itself, not going through things like LVM, et cetera. So I guess you can kind of quantify storage into three different types now, right? You have block storage, file storage, and object storage. Block storage is data stored in fixed size or blocks in a rigid arrangement, ideal for enterprise databases, things that need highly performance, maybe extremely serialized workloads, things like that. File storage, something everyone's familiar with. You go to your company, and there's some magical drive that's mapped to everyone's laptop in the company, and they all dump all of their files in this magical drive. That's file storage, right? And then object storage. Data stored as objects, scalable buckets. Ideal for unstructured big data, content, files, pictures, videos, the Snapchats that you take of your cats when they do funny things. A lot of unstructured big data, people use it for analytics and archiving. Object storage is really big in the archiving space, the backup space. That's where a lot of enterprise folks are bridging their need with this new technology. So a simplified view of the difference between the three different things would be, if you took it as a parking analogy, block storage is the parking lot where data is stored very rigidly in defined blocks. Access is a specific space location. File storage is the parking garage where things are arranged in hierarchical levels. And object storage is like valet parking. You don't even know where it is, where it's been, or where it's going to be. You just need that stub that says, I want my car, and then you'll get your car. Whether it's spread over 50 different pieces of hardware, or whether it's on one, you have that global unique identifier, and you get your data. So every organization has block and file. If you go to any organization, they're going to have some sort of file where people are storing their documents. And they're going to have some sort of block, where whether it's databases, file systems, or servers, etc. And direct attached SAN was born from block, right? Back in the day, everything was just direct attached. And they started saying, okay, well, let's externalize this and put it into a lot of it. And then that's where the SAN was born. It was also the birth of the storage admin, right? So now there's running around as their storage engineers, and all they do is set up these huge enterprise blobs of storage from EMC and IBM and others, and they cut them up into logical arrays and then present them as a disk to all the servers. As well as I said before, most organizations have file, so the big big network drive that everyone dumps their files into. It's usually on like a NetApp filer that just presents a SIF share, stuff like that. So what problem is Object trying to solve? So you can see in the 80s, 90s, 2000s, 2010, structured data, this line right here, is also growing. There's no doubt that just data in itself is growing. Data is the new oil, as they say. There's just a lot of it. But unstructured data is growing at explosive rates. So there needs to be, that's the problem that people are solving with object storage. And some of the characteristics that you'll see of object storage is that it scales just infinitely. And which, you know, lends itself to this insane curve that we're seeing. EMC, one of the biggest, you know, storage vendors in the world, projected that data would grow to 40 zettabytes by 2020. How important that data is, I don't know. Pretty narcissistic society, so it's probably just pictures of ourselves in this, but.
And cats.
And cats, but there's a lot of data. So object storage scales infinitely, it can be highly performing, and it allows you to just spread super horizontally instead of vertically, which always tends to be more expensive. So what is object storage? Object storage is a hierarchy-free method of storing data. Unlike other data storage methods, object-based storage does not involve some sort of directory tree. Everything's flat in an object store. Discrete units of data exist at the same level in the storage folder, as we said. Each object has a unique identifying name that applications can use to retrieve it. Additionally, objects also may have metadata retrieved with it. So key features, again, data is stored as discrete objects. Data is not placed in directories. Again, applications identify discrete using unique addresses. This is important because newer applications are now reading and writing directly native objects, so it removes the need for things like LVM and file systems and files themselves. And it's also often compared to valet parking. The data object is like the car and the address is the receipt.
Are you talking about file systems here? Because everything you've described here could be stored in a regular traditional file system.
Could be, yeah. But then you subject yourself to file system limitations for something, for example. So if you have 80 petabytes of data, you gotta now pick and choose how you're gonna scale file system wise and all the limitations that performance wise.
Sure.
So it's not, you could do this. This is all things that you can store this data on file systems and applications can already read file systems. That's true. So I'm not saying that this is something unique to file systems. This is just the way they're doing it. So it might make more sense when I show the how it actually works. Again, this is a test driver, so maybe I'll need to pick it up. But it's designed for access at the application layer for the app to use an API call, like a REST call, instead of going to the file system. So why object storage? Object storage scales infinitely because it scales horizontally. Object storage avoids vendor lock-in. This allows you to use commodity hardware, any hardware you want, buy hardware off eBay, allows you to use open source software, and a lot of people are saying, a lot of vendors are saying, bring your own hardware, use our free software, and just pay us for support. That's the CC and the Red Hat model. Of course, there's also proprietary implementations, which I'll go over. Object storage exists in the cloud, it was born in the cloud, and it kind of started with Amazon S3, you know what Amazon S3 is, and that kind of, now it's confusing. You say Amazon S3, do you mean the Amazon S3 the product, or do you mean Amazon S3 the implementation and protocol? Because there's all these other products that speak S3, but that are not S3, so you gotta figure that out.
So if, sure. if, if, if,
it looks like object storage is one of the things that Scala was created to manage and get to because of the scalability.
I wouldn't say Scala was made.
Scala
is just supposed to be highly parallelized.
It's just another language built on the JVM.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't think it.
Yeah.
Right.
I don't think it relates.
No.
No.
Sure. Yeah, they seem kind of separate.
Yeah, it's pretty separate. Most APIs that connect to object storage are going to be your, you know, Java, Ruby, Python.
Can you go back a slide, actually? I think that's when you discovered, when you were talking about like how to access it, there was like some REST
So REST, basically. If your language can speak SOAP REST, you can access it.
Okay, so you don't have to worry about traditional IO aggregation like you would want to if you want to like get the best. Okay.
Yeah, so there's things like multi-part upload, stuff like that, that's built into the S3 protocol, if you will. But it's really just puts and gets. Very, very easy. So if you want to write an object, you put it, and then the file, or put the data. If you want to get it, it's just get, and then the unique identifier.
So. One last question. Sure. Object stores, are they better doing deduplication then of data?
I don't think so. No,
okay.
I think dedupe is something that lends itself to having a file system.
It's kind of physical level. This is not physical level here, right?
So
not necessarily physical level.
Well,
isn't this just an abstraction?
Yes and no. Is it an abstraction?
I guess my question is,
it scales near infinite. It has to be an abstraction of kind.
Yeah, it's definitely an abstraction. But for deduplication, I don't think it doesn't do deduplication because this software is mainly based around the idea of replication. So.
How many nodes there? I'm trying to count how many objects I can store before I'm going to lose one.
A lot. I think
it's
11 nodes.
Like a couple, how many cat pictures a day is
one, that? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6.
Trillions. What file format are you using?
If there's anyone who can tell us that a picture we lost would be 4chan.
Where's that number coming from?
That's coming directly from Amazon.
From where?
Amazon.
Yeah, that's the S3 number.
That's the S3 number, yes. It's some ridiculous number where they just because when you do a single write, I believe on S3, it's your data is replicated 7 times. So you write a 1 gig file, they're writing 7 gigs on there. Their availability is only 4 nines, 99.99, but their durability, they're saying we will never ever lose one of your objects. So who's doing object storage? Basically everybody. Zeus has a protocol, CES, Enterprise Storage. It's based on Ceph, which is open source. Red Hat has almost the exact same offering, also based on Ceph. OpenStack, you might have heard of Swift, that's another very large object storage project that's open source and free. EMC Dell, and who is actually the leader in the object storage arena, Gordon Gartner, if you believe that. They have a product called Elastic Cloud Storage, which is basically an appliance, right? Install your appliance, install a bunch more, maybe different data centers, and then it all hooks together, and it's moving objects around, and you don't have to worry about it. You don't need a team of 3 sysadmins to implement, the open source version. This is all done for you. Same thing with IBM. IBM has a product called Cloud Object Storage, formerly known as CleverSafe, who's also a leader in that industry. And it's a really expensive appliance that you put in, and then you put in a couple other data centers, and they all integrate, and you can lose a whole data center and won't lose any data. Amazon S3, everyone knows what S3 is, but it's basically a cloud engineering, which is completely global. If you write an object to Amazon S3, it's not specific to any region, it's worldwide. Oracle also has a kind of S3 derivative with their cloud offering. It's called Oracle Cloud Infrastructure Object Storage, which very much like their company, is very long-winded and probably great it's gonna be. Microsoft has a product called Blob Storage, which I guess they're trying to be hip with the kids. It's called Blob.
Microsoft Blob.
Yes.
It's like Bob from
Blob.
Yeah. It's literally called Blob Storage.
Oh my God!
If you Google it, it's called Microsoft Blob Storage. So. HP Invest or Bot or something, this company called Scalability. They have some really long product called HPE Scalable Object Storage with Scalability Ring, whatever that means. Also, clients are proprietary. NetApp has other proprietary, so does Pure Systems. Pure is a really hot product on the market for block storage. So basically, anyone who's anyone in the big enterprise block has come out with some sort of object offering. From what we can tell from these vendors and talking to them, they're all kind of doing the same thing. They're all scrambling to convince people that they need block, or that they need object. And they do that by kind of toting this idea of extreme durability and reliability at the expense of maybe even locking into the hardware. Because even with, like, I know with IBM's offering, you don't need to buy their hardware. So you can run their software on whatever hardware you want. As long, and if you want support, then it's certified on, you know, let's say Supermicro. So I think a lot of these proprietary ones, it's just the software that's proprietary. All the hardware, you can use whatever hardware you want. And that's the difference between enterprise block that most enterprises have, is that you're using their hardware and you're using their software. With object storage, you're either using free and open source software or you're using proprietary software on whatever hardware you want. So this is kind of a visual example of the differences between file storage, block storage, and object storage, where object storage doesn't have any hierarchy. Everything is just a flat pool with a global unique identifier. Another example, so.
Can you go back?
Sure.
So, then what happens when you delete objects? It's got to manage that pool, basically do what the file system, what a conventional file system does.
I mean, you delete it, it just goes
away. Right, yeah, but you can, it's got to pull stuff, right? Like, imagine you've got, does it have to go through and do the equivalent of defragging that space?
Nope.
To do it?
No sort of fragmentation.
Because people don't delete things that are there, because once you start, you have this big pool of stuff and you start adding things and deleting it, you're going to get fragmentation.
Okay. So to answer your question, do people delete things? Should they? Yes. Do they? No.
Well, in the case that they do delete it, I'm not sure how it handles fragmentation, but I can only speak from experience in the Ceph world, which is one of the bigger object storage implementations. And I think the way it works is you have a bucket, and then when you write to it, it splits, let's say you have a 1KB file, right? And you write that 1KB file to your bucket, and then it slices it up into n amounts of data, depending on how much replication and durability that you want. And then it spreads it over the hardware, over the OSDs. What happens when you delete it? I don't know, because I think the way it works is the slices goes into like a little bucket, and yeah, I'm not sure. I'll have to ask one of our
staff. I'm trying to understand how this is different than just what a file system is doing, which is a different front end.
Amazon side is the only one I've used. Since they're writing it in so many different places, maybe they're just spinning up new ones and clustering stuff together and deal with it that way.
I don't know. I'll find out and I'll post it to our secret list. But I know that the reason how it's different from traditional file systems is that there's literally no limitations whatsoever. Every file system has a limitation. There's literally no limitations.
So, file system,
space limitations, yes, because you're trading space for time, aren't you?
What do you mean?
Ultimately? Well, if you are saying that there's no limitation,
right?
In today's language, that means you're probably going to be parallel over many nodes.
Oh, absolutely.
Okay, so, so one limitation is going to be the speed of your network.
Yeah, so one of the
That's the time-space trade-off I'm talking about.
Yeah, so one of the things about object storage that's important is there's usually like three networks involved with any kind of object storage implementation: cluster network, manager network, and then the user network, how you get input things. That becomes very important. Yeah, but the reason why it's so hyperscale is that it scales horizontally, where you know you have, let's say, you know, it's kind of chunked up into compute and storage together. So when you need to add more capacity, you just throw another node in. You just keep adding nodes and nodes and nodes. And how it's placing the data is all configured when you build the cluster. With you write a meg of data, how that gets replicated X amount of time, that all gets you configure that when you create the cluster. So that's the reason why it can scale so so hyper.
But you're always subject to the speed of the cluster.
Yes. Yeah, but it's not like if you grow your cluster by 10, it's not like your data is spread over 10 times.
No. Yeah. I got it. But it's also not like if you have an 8 terabyte drive on your local machine that you can get it as fast as you can get it from there.
Sure, absolutely. Right. Like I said, it's very network dependent.
Yeah.
And
so if you go back to the car lot analogy, it's what's on your machine is like the cache, and where the actual car lot is, where you buy the car, and what's in on the object store is kind of like Detroit where they built them. Well, right. back in the days when they did build them in Detroit.
Yeah, well, like I said, object storage is you have the valet ticket. You don't care, don't even know where this thing's located. In a file system, block storage, you know exactly where it's located, right? With object storage, you have no idea, nor do you care, because your application's just doing get and then the object ID. That's all it cares about.
I mean, at a low level, that's what a file system is doing, too. I mean, you've got that hierarchy drawn on top, but at a low level, it's happening exactly the way you described. It's the operating system, the file system is writing things out for the entire disk to get the chunks. It's kind of a quote-unquote valet to pull it out. You don't know where the data is stored.
Right.
I'm not following this analogy.
The application,
because it sounds exactly the same.
The application doesn't know where the data is on block storage, but you're utilizing system drivers and system software that does know where it's at. With this, the applications are literally just doing a REST get. That's all they're doing. We're doing get and then the object ID. That's all they're doing.
Something's gotta pull it out.
Yeah, it's not magic. Something is pulling it out, but from an application perspective.
From the application perspective on EXT4, I'm isolated from the magic of going out to a RAID drive and pulling it all.
Oh, but you're looking up the directory and you're finding where it's located, right?
Once to connect to it, just like you're once to connect to the object storage.
Yeah, but so for example, of an application, you have a directory, right, called MNT, and you need to do a list and find all the files in MNT, and it's files 1, 2, and 3, and then you're reading that file in, right?
I mean, it depends what you build on top of that. I mean, that's one way to do it.
Sure, that's the way I would say that, like, let's say a Python app, for example, and if you're reading a bunch of files into your application, wouldn't you scan the directory, look at all the files, and then, or maybe it already knows about the file, and then you read the file, right?
I could have it stored in a database, or, I mean, there's lots of different ways.
Right, but what I'm saying in object storage is you're just doing a REST get, that's all you're doing. And then the object, wherever that's located is where it's located. Now, there is some principles that overlap. I'm not trying to say that this is completely different, but there are limitations to block storage that object storage does not have. I guess that's one of the main differences between them.
So what file systems on the disks are you restricted to use that, or does it use its own type of like file system, and it's like another layer on top of, let's say, like, it's like TXT4 or something like that.
Oh, you mean like on the act when you're
on the actual disk, yeah.
On the actual like object storage.
Yeah.
Well, I mean the proprietary stuff is obviously all proprietary.
Yeah. But with Ceph, what's your
experience with Ceph? I'm not sure what it is. It might even be raw devices.
Okay.
I'll ask one of our Ceph guys. So this is kind of how it works, right? So RBD is Radios Block Device, which allows you to present objects as a block device. So your application doesn't need to speak direct to objects. You can use RBD or CephFS. Basically, you write data and it goes through, this is the Ceph, specifically the Ceph. But you write data, you say put data, right? And then you have something called the crush map, which decides how much replication you have, how much durability and redundancy, and it splits the data up into placement groups, and then those placement groups talk to different nodes in your cluster. That's how it achieves redundancy. That's how you could lose an entire data center and still have all of your data. So here's another visual example of object, the pool, and then you can see how in the placement group pools, like red, 10, 10, 10, 10, and you can kind of see how it's placed on the cluster side. I'm not going too super deep on actually how Ceph works, but that's basically how objects work. So your applications can either speak native object, which is a REST API, or it can speak, or if your application is like a legacy application that can speak file or block, these companies have created like bridges that take object storage, and so you have this big object storage implementation, right? It's like, let's say it's 50 petabytes. We have these servers that sit in front of it that translate object to file. So you can still, that's how these big enterprise object storage vendors are trying to displace like existing filers, is they're saying, well, you can buy our object storage, you can still have your network drive that all the Windows clients connect to and dump your documents into. You just gotta use our NAS bridge. And that's a server that sits in front of this cluster that translates object into files, so that way you can mount a drive from the NAS bridge to your Windows desktop storage. Same thing for block devices. Except in Ceph, there's actually a what's known as a Radios Block Device, which allows you to present, let's say, like an image to a server that would be stored in your cluster. So I'll give a demonstration of a quick put and quick get being asked.
No, it's not going to go away until they close the door.
Who has the door?
The cleaners.
Oh.
Okay, so in this directory, I have a file called AWS, and it has my API key, which allows me to talk to my S3 account. Cat it because Charlie's videotaping this. I don't want $1 million charge on my Amazon account when it gets posted to Google Plus and otherwise. But
you can attempt to edit something though.
Yeah, it's red.
Jesus.
Let's create a S3 bucket. called, I'm going to do this for plug test 123. And we'll create a file called hey plug. This is plug west. Copy a plug to S3 plug test. And I uploaded that file to S3. That's basically a plug.
So for demo purposes, like if we were to play around with this, like with simple text files, that kind of stuff, how much would we expect to pay for, based on your experience with dev instances, that kind of stuff?
S3 and any other derivatives on IBM or in Azure, it's really cheap. It's like less than a penny a gig.
So oh, okay.
S3 is part of Amazon's free 12-month tier. So if you haven't opened one yet, an account yet, or you have one and you're still in the first year.
I'm holding back until I start my AWS training, which is very soon.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so if you go out to...
you can play with it. S3 cheap.
Yeah.
Load balancing is not in the free tier, and you gotta want that.
Yes. If you go to, if I say
not for the certificate.
If I wanted to write, let's say 10 terabytes of data.
Oh.
It's $235. So.
Is that all?
$23 for a terabyte.
I thought the 15 petabytes you mentioned earlier.
Just for fun.
Your monthly bill would be
$347,000.
It's almost free.
That's standard storage. So
they have zettabytes or yottabytes on that list?
Knowledge piece.
So if you have reduced redundancy, for example, it's only it's around the same price.
What does it cost on Glacier?
Yeah, Glacier's got to be cheaper.
Yeah, Glacier.
I see a request, I don't see.
Remember, I think it was Glacier was pretty
cheap. Andy, just don't hit next on that, okay?
Yeah. That's just
the storage is cheap. Getting it out is expensive.
Yeah, getting it out is really expensive in Glacier. I mean, if you wrote 10 petabytes and then you needed to read it all back, you're going out of business. It's really expensive.
Well, it depends on how fast you want it back.
Yeah, that too. It's really slow. Yeah.
If you opt real slow, you can get it back.
So that's one example of.
Okay, so that file you uploaded is an object.
Yes.
In this terminology.
Yep.
And then how do you get that back? You'd say get hey plug, and then you get that back. So you have to know the name of the file.
Yeah.
And everything's a file then.
I don't know how it's written to underneath, whether they're using raw devices, whether they're using a file system underneath, but...
Well, that's like the key is that whatever you, so you named it that,
right?
So, and that's the key that you use to get it back?
So you can have different, you can have, within the same bucket, they have to be, everything has to be different. You can't have, obviously, two objects of the same name. But you can do it by file name. So you can do a AWS S3 LS, and that lists all the buckets. And then you can do LS plug test 123, and there's the file. If I do plug, there's probably some sort of command that shows all the metadata associated with the text file a plug, whether it's that unique identifier, or whether other metadata information. I think one of the things that when people are storing a lot of data in object storage, they need a fast way to query what's in there. So I think a lot of people have an external metadata store, maybe a database that references metadata about the objects.
Are these objects really just, they seem like they're files. Are they not files?
Yeah, they're files.
So they're files.
Yeah, so it's, the object has the metadata contained within it, which is programmable too. I think you can store whatever kind of metadata you want with that file. But everything's self-contained in that object. And you just need to know object name or the unique identifier to retrieve it. Whether that's placed here or whether that's, you know, in a data center in Texas and it's being replicated asynchronously, that's the appeal of object. So
is this what they're calling an object file system? Is an object storage is really a distributed file system? Isn't it just a distributed file system? I'm confused about what this is and why they're using the term object.
Not necessarily. So.
MongoDB calls these documents. Are these documents?
Right. I wouldn't think so. It's a self-contained object that contains your data and the metadata. In the example here, your application needs some way to talk to this, right? So you have your application here, right? App. And then it needs to read a file. So in this case, that file system may be local to that, maybe to that applications that are running on the server, right? Or if it's distributed, you are talking maybe over something like NFS or something like that. Well, this is more so in your app, and then over the network, you're saying get file.
Right. So somewhere in my app, I'm saying, I'm connecting to whatever we're calling this, what we're calling it, plug test 123,
yep.
I'm saying get a plug, and it's going to return to
the file. Yep. Or you can also interact with it to read the metadata about it. So I guess that's really the difference. Local or talking over some sort of distributed protocol, or directly to the endpoint address.
Feels like a file system.
It sure does.
One big difference in the Amazon world is you can't use it to set up your server and have it be the drive that's running, that holds the actual Linux on it.
Can you make directories in this?
You can make directories and stuff. And you can also have it so that I have two websites where you put the files in the bucket, and then you just say, if someone goes to the URL, just serve them up like it's a real thing, but there's no server backing it.
Yeah, static web pages. So it is kind of like a file system, if you think about it that way. It's just that you can access it with a load balanced URL and just get your file, and you don't need your file system local to your application. And it scales infinitely. So I guess those are probably the two different things that are maybe a little bit different than a local file system. And as for, you can have your, you know, Linux OS running in your object storage. There's something called Radius Block Device, which has been in the Linux kernel since 2.6, I think. And basically, you create an image inside your object storage, and then it gets presented to your operating system as a block device. And then that image is chunked up and moved all around, so that way you can still have the high availability. So that was Amazon. This is OpenAttic. This is SUSE's, this is their management colorful front end for their Ceph cluster. And just to illustrate, you know, they have a nice little front end in front of this thing where you can look at the number of storage nodes you have and Radius Block Devices, which we were just talking about, how, you know, this is a Radius Block Device called Demo. It's 200 gigabytes. That 200 gigabyte blob is stored in object storage, which is distributed over a bunch of number of hardware nodes in the cluster, and then it's presented to your Linux operating system as a block device, and you can boot off of it, you can do whatever you want. So that's cool. So one of the cool use cases is, so from some of these proprietary ones, this is IBM's, the other ones do something similar. Basically, you can have an on-prem huge object store, and let's say that your company doesn't have enough money for the separate data center. You can tier it to other clouds, whether they're public cloud, whether they're IBM's. So it's kind of like having three data centers, right, instead of your one. Or you could do mirroring. So the idea is that you write an object and it gets mirrored to the other side. So that's kind of a cool use case. Shutterfly, another cool use case. I sat in a presentation for these guys who they had 80 petabytes of data. And it was all sitting on file systems, and it was just not scaling. They were running into limitations, performance issues, etc. So they moved all of their images to object storage, multiple data centers, and one of the cool side benefits that they found was when they needed to do data center moves, they literally just went through and they unplug everything, because everything is so hyper redundant. They went through and they unplug everything, they take the servers, throw them in the back of the trucks, they move to another data center, they plug them in, put their new IP address in, or if they keep the same IP, I don't know what the network diagram is, but they just literally move it, plug it back in, and their cluster resyncs itself. Mm-hmm. So they're able to move an entire data center, X amount of months, which would have been an absolute nightmare before with moving all the data around and whatnot. But that's one cool benefit that, I mean, 80 petabytes, that's quite a bit of data.
What about the geo or regional difference or something like that with data storage for application? Is there something special that you have to do? Let's say if you have something here and you have another pool of data in England or something.
Well, all the object storage vendors are going to do it a little bit differently, but mm-hmm. I don't think there's anything special you need to do. It's just it's all about how much replication you want each piece of data to have, whether you want it, you know, five times redundant, twice redundant, three times redundant, and then, you know, just the nodes in the cluster, whether they're spread over, you know, geographic area.
Then I know that with Lustre, there's some certain limitations where if it doesn't have enough redundancy, it goes to read-only.
This does the same thing where I think it, at least in some of the vendors, if it reaches a critical mode, it'll go into, you can do gets, but you can't do puts, basically.
Okay, cool.
So a lot of people are using is they're using their object storage as kind of a queue, right? You have an S3 bucket, and you have some sort of message queue sitting in front of it, and when files drop into that bucket, your queues start to get and process that data, and then it drains out and you're done. So because it's so hyperscale, whether a terabyte of data drops into that bucket or whether it's a megabyte, it's used in that fashion, which I think is pretty cool. So you can build message queues and stuff around the object store, much like you can do regular file system too, right? You can have something that is constantly, you know, doing directory scans. Greg works on a product that's what we do, is we scan the directory. We scan it, and it sees a new file, it starts to process it. This is the same type of concept, where you have a message queue broker that's either doing a long poll, where it's keeping the connection open and looking for data, or it's constantly doing short pulls, where it's checking that S3 bucket, and when data drops into it, it starts to pull that data out, process it with, you know, send it over to servers or serverless functions, etc. So this is a common use case that people use S3 for and other object stores. But object stores are just not for objects. So object storage can be used for block storage as well. Create a VM with a 100 gig disk. That 100 gig disk is a object. And these block devices are thin provisionable, they're resizable, they store data striped over multiple OSDs in the cluster, which is, that's their hard, their storage nodes. It uses some of the capabilities like snapshotting, replication, and consistency. So one of the cool things you can do with an RBD, with a Rados block device, is you can do, you can create a copy of it, and it's available instantly because it does copy and write. So if you have a 100 gig disk and you want to make a copy of it and boot another Linux server up with that copy, how much storage would that take up? Chris? 200 gig, you think, right? Well, since it does copy and write, it's only taking up 100 gig. So you have 100 gig long, yeah. You make a clone of that 100 gigs, and it's only using 100 gigs until you start changing some of the data, and then it grows. So that's one of the cool features you can do. And it interacts using kernel modules or libRPC. This is kind of how it works. You have your VM, and KVM is providing some of the RBD libraries, and then your data is then, you know, split amongst the cluster, which gives you the redundancy, it gives you the ability to move your data around, allows you to do the snapshotting, and all the other cool features that, you know, Enterprise Block has been doing for a while today. So, yeah,
sure. Oh, and that last slide, it's probably nothing but says vibratos?
So that's Rados, so it's a Rados block device, and then libRados is the library that's used to do the magic where you're converting from block to object. I'm not too familiar with this layer, I just know that it's some sort of magic library that exists that leaves.
Magic library.
So you might ask yourself, with these huge storage implementations, you have, let's say, 80 petabytes of data, who's actually maintaining this thing? Is it the storage admins or is it the Linux admins? Right, because these object storage clusters are usually running on Linux, right? Ceph is one of the, arguably, the Swift and Ceph are the two biggest open source object storage projects, but who's running it? Is it in your enterprise? Is it the storage engineer or is it the Linux engineer? Well, the vendors that we've talked to say it's a good mix of both. Some organizations, the storage admins are ordering this software and hardware, installing it, and maintaining it. In other places, it's the Linux admins, because it's, you need to know a lot about Linux sometimes to get these things up and running. I know with Ceph install, it's super complicated. It's not a point-and-click thing, unless you're going with one of the vendors, like SUSE or Red Hat. But the free open source, you know, community version, it's really complicated. So it's a good mix between Linux engineers and storage engineers. The storage folks are being forced to learn Linux, which is probably a lot of grumbling about that. And the Linux folks are maybe learning some storage principles and requirements from their users. These installations are also frequently managed with config management tools. So when you maybe buy the SUSE version or the Red Hat version, you're installing it with their config management. And it's a whole new world for storage admins who maybe spent their time implementing Enterprise Block. So to recap, object storage is the solution to a huge data explosion. It's infinitely scalable. It was born in the cloud. You can use it for native objects. Your application speaks the S3 protocol and gets and puts files. You can use it as a block device using Rados block devices or some other bridge. And you can use it as a NAS or a file using some other software that sits in front of that. Any questions?
So how much metadata is usually stuck to a file?
I don't know. I think it's programmable. I think So if you go to, let's look at our metadata that we uploaded. The answer is, I don't know, but let's look.
Wouldn't it be configurable?
It is, I know that. But what, like, inherently, what, for our file, like, let's see what's school. Plug test, 1, 3, aplog, there's our file. So, modified time, owner, etag, what storage class it is, encryption, size, and then the length of the file. So this is where you maybe tag things, right? So content type. So if I add metadata, you do expiration, content type.
SHA 256.
So I guess it's kind of anything, right? So so if I said, let's say expires, and then you can put maybe a timestamp when you want it to expire.
So there's hard limits on what you can configure. It's not.
I guess in this case in Amazon's, right? Amazon's everything is, you know, it's not free form, right? It's right. This is the service that they're providing to you. Okay. With Ceph.
Well, but it's got tags, so you can do anything you want to tag. It's essentially the same.
Yeah, I guess the key, it only gives you so much key though. Unless it's this, I guess maybe this is the free form tag. But when you go to open it up, there's only so many things that are here. I'm definitely not an expert in this. So I'm learning as it goes. But I know that one of the concerns that some of the folks we have were about metadata. And I know I heard one vendor say that some people are externalizing their metadata for really fast access. So this is some of the metadata I guess you can add to it. So if I put in, hey, this is meta, alpha. Let's see. And how you query this, the metadata, I don't know. I'm sure there's some sort of flag with the AWS. I'm sure there's some way to query that metadata, I just don't know how. But all I know is that objects contain the data and some other metadata that you can configure. Any other questions? Well, I'll figure out a way to explain it better, so maybe I can explain it, the differences between a file system and objects storage correctly. But I'll figure that out.
Well, it's still neat.
Yeah. No, and I think there's a lot of overlap between right block storage, file systems, LBs. There's a lot of overlap. I think when it comes down to it, it's the fact that, you know, it's not a local file system. It's some load balance link that you just connect to, right? Just object storage dot, you know, the ETS group dot com. And wherever that data is, whether it's here, whether it's in our data center over Malvern, you know, you're getting that data back.
What would be the best way if you have Ceph set up or some other object data store and you had multiple like ways of querying it? Like, would you go down like the AWS route and have like multiple like REST APIs where you would call it up?
You mean?
And then like have like HA proxy do it and do some load balancing? Like, what would be the best way to handle lots of requests coming in for your own object data store?
Well, I think it's like anything else. That part of it scales as needed. So the only thing I know about that is IBM's implementation, the front end can scale to handle more requests from clients. So the number of connections, the response time to and from is all monitored, and then you can scale that front end And then when you overload the back end, obviously then you need to scale the back end, but that's typically, that's the front end and the back end scales independently.
Okay.
So you have like, kind of like retrievers and then slicers, which slices up the data on the back end, and then the retriever maybe is the front end guy that scales independently, depending on the number.
Okay, cool.
So you have like a mixed public-private file system. Well, can you like tier it so that you can say, hey, I really want you to try to read from my private ones before you go out to read from the cloud? Or put the old data out on the cloud and keep the old data.
You can definitely tier objects in different locations depending on the age. And you can tier it based on performance. So if you have a certain set of objects you want to pin in flash storage versus in nearline, then you do that in different pools. As for whether you'd want to query the private data first than the public, that'd probably be something that, since the applications now speak direct to object over API, it's probably something you just handle in your language, in your app. I think all these implementations have the idea of transparent tiering, to where, you know, you write your data and then maybe 30 days later, if it hasn't been read, you can tier it off somewhere. But I don't know if there's the idea of, hey, try to go here before you go here first. I don't know if it